Hello, my name is Andrew Sudbury, and I'd like to welcome you to the Entrepreneurs Panel. We have assembled here an august body, some of whom are actually entrepreneurs. Others are venture capitalists, and we have a counselor as well at the end. I'll let everyone introduce themselves, and then we're going to talk about security companies, how to start one, how to get funded, lessons for how to grow it and exit successfully. A little bit of technical difficulties. I guess we'll just start at this end then and let each of the panelists introduce themselves.
I'm Dave Gamel. I'm a partner at Brown Rudnick. Our law firm is an international law firm that has offices in London, New York, Boston. Okay, thank you. And my practice in particular focuses on emerging growth companies, small startups through their life cycle. I'm the chair of that practice within our firm here in Boston.
I'm Jeff Bagnon. I'm a partner with Atlas Venture in Waltham. I've been investing in companies since 1999. Had the pleasure of investing in some of the companies that are part of this conference, DataPower, Bit9, Veracode. And my focus areas are really enterprise and internet infrastructure.
My name is Eugene Kuznetsov. I started DataPower in 99. That was acquired by IBM. And now I'm looking at other ideas in the security space and potentially thinking of starting another security company.
And my name is Maria Serino. I'm a partner with 406 Ventures. It's an early stage venture capital firm that I actually helped form 2 years ago. I was talked into this business by illustrious folks like Sim and Jeff. Before being a venture capitalist, I was an entrepreneur, started a security company in 2000 called Garden, sold it to VeriSign 4 years later, and then before that held a series of sales and marketing operating roles in a bunch of companies.
Hi, I'm Sim Siminov. I'm a partner with Polaris Venture Partners, so I guess that fits the VC category. Before then, I was an entrepreneur at a company called Allaire, which built the first web app server, and long before I did a fair amount of hacking, but nothing at the level of you folks in the audience.
Thank you all. I feel like a game show host with this microphone. And since I feel that way, I think I'll start by asking some questions. So how many people here think they have a good idea for a security company? Anyone? Please raise your hands.
I see a few people. How many of you actually want to start a company or have recently started a company based on that kind of idea? There's a few more. So let's take a start at the beginning with the idea. I guess the first question I'd like to ask is, how do you know that you have a good idea? What is the steps you should take to actually vet your idea? And I'd like to hear the answer both from the side of the view or perspective of an entrepreneur, as well as from the venture capitalist perspective. How do you actually test whether or not an idea has legs? And since we started at this end with the introductions, I guess we'll start with Sim at this end. So perhaps you could answer as an entrepreneur first. How did you vet the idea that you had at first? And then we'll let the others respond from the VC side.
Well, we didn't. We suffered an anti-pattern of entrepreneurs, which is you believe you're right. And so your idea must be a really good idea, and then you just build it, and then people come. And we ended up being lucky in that we ended up in this tiny fraction of entrepreneurs whose idea actually turned out to be right at the right time also, and our company took off. We were bootstrapped on only $18,000, and by the time we got venture investment, we were already on second version of product and kind of a real company. But in general, that's not how it works out. You know, in general, the idea that the entrepreneur has actually turns out not to be such a great idea, and if you just go and spend time to build it, buyers usually don't come. In fact, it's a well-known fact that most companies that end up succeeding very rarely end up succeeding doing the thing that they originally started doing, and there's plenty of evidence to that. So ultimately, the ultimate vet of an idea is people buying a lot of whatever you're building. Unfortunately, it takes a long time, so then you got to think about what earlier signs of the idea being a good one can you get. The best one is talking to some really smart people who have done similar things around the space that you're doing, sort of leveraging pattern recognition and leveraging analogies to figure out whether what you want to do is actually a good thing before you invest a lot of your life in it. And I think a mistake that entrepreneurs often make is not to think about the opportunity cost of their own time. If you're a really smart person, you should be thinking about, you know, if I'm going to spend a month working on something, what's the best thing that I can spend this month working on?
Interesting. And so I guess when you're from the VC side, I presume you do not assume that all entrepreneurs have great ideas and that you should invest in them. So maybe you could give us some examples of some of the tests or the ways that you vet some of the business plans that you must see.
Sure. And it's very, actually very similar. I mean, I think, you know, as an entrepreneur prior to being an investor, it's exactly the way I would test out ideas, you know, before starting a company as well. Go talk to a bunch of really smart people. As Sim said, you know, I had the benefit of having a really great Rolodex of, you know, IT CIOs and folks in IT who would buy a lot of solutions. And that was the way I vetted sort of the idea for Guardant back in 99 and 2000. And that's we take a similar approach to how we look at companies. You know, we really look at, first of all, the folks walking in the door with either the idea or the technology. Who are these folks? You know, why do we think that they're exciting? And then, you know, we start to push them in terms of who they've talked to. And if they don't have necessarily the potential customer Rolodexes, we try to help them with that. And I don't think you can actually have enough early conversations with people who might ultimately benefit from using your service or your product. And that really tells you everything you need to know. And so as an investor, we help facilitate that, but we really look for that as well.
Okay. So let's assume that I've had some of these conversations. I think my idea has legs. And then I decide, since the new fashionable thing seems to be bootstrapping companies again, I guess we'll talk about that a little bit later. So let's assume I actually want to bootstrap my company. So there's a couple questions around that I guess we can ask. One is, you know, is that a good idea? And if so, how far should I take it before I actually seek, you know, outside investment to scale my company? I don't know. Well, I guess we can progress down the line. But Eugene, when you started Data Power, how far did you try to bootstrap your company? Did you contemplate it and so forth?
Yeah, we bootstrapped it for probably about a year and a half. And I would say that my takeaway on that was that while it was necessary for us at the time, I wouldn't recommend it. I mean, if you don't have to do it, and if it's something that ultimately, as an idea, as a market, as a type of company, requires outside venture capital, you might as well get the venture capital up front. But that's my personal opinion, because I don't think you end up getting the credit for spending a year and a half bootstrapping and not taking a salary. So if you can get money earlier from angels or from institutional investors, get the money earlier if it's the kind of idea that ultimately is going to require capital. Now, of course, if you're fortunate like, you know, Allaire, and you're never going to need capital, you might not need capital until much later, then you can bootstrap all the way. But I think doing it halfway in between in the end doesn't really give you any extra value and potentially waste time while competitors who are better funded build out their teams and build out their products.
So one of the things I've been told makes panels exciting is when people argue. So I'm going to ask Jeff, do you agree with Eugene that entrepreneurs don't get credit for the years or time they put in bootstrapping? Or do you see that as an advantage? Maybe they've actually built something that you know is likely to succeed and it's just your job to scale it with some capital?
I think Eugene actually got a lot of credit for the bootstrapping at Data Power. you know, I think what it showed was, you know, Eugene went out there and showed his dedication and his passion for an idea and the fact that, you know, willing to attract talent to come and help him, you know, achieve that idea. You know, that spoke volumes to us. You know, and I think somebody who's willing to put in that type of, you know, personal wealth and sweat equity, you know, that's the conviction sometimes that we have to see that gets us over the line, because at the end of the day, we're investing in an entrepreneur. I would say that I think bootstrapping can be a very good idea, but to Eugene's point, if you see a competitive window or if you see a market window that's closing and you know that in order to hit that market window and that market window is a substantial window, I think that you should look at how you can leverage that bootstrapping with external funds. I would say that I think venture capital is only applicable to a small amount of businesses. I think actually venture capital has killed more businesses than it's actually helped. And I think a lot of companies can be interesting companies and achieve, you know, interesting founder liquidity and solve some problems, but there's only really a subset that should take that type of capital, and you better know exactly what you're going to do if you take that capital. You know, trying to buy your way into a business, you know, once you've taken that capital is a very bad idea, and I think, you know, all of us, you know, here on this panel know a lot of entrepreneurs that have been extremely frustrated as they've continued to push a lot of venture capital money, and that preference ahead of them before they actually get paid for their idea.
It's interesting. I want to get back to that idea of venture capital and hurting venture capital hurting companies. But before we do that, I guess I want to ask David, when companies are bootstrapping themselves, are there things that they do structurally that end up being significant problems down the line, either in how they structure their corporation or their shares? I mean, what are the sort of common issues you see with bootstrap companies that you would not otherwise see if it was, you know, a clean venture start?
So I think one of the biggest issues is just complete structure and creating a expectation and then documenting that expectation. Once you enter a transaction with a venture capitalist, they're going to ensure that your relationships are documented and that you've created, you know, the proper expectations, you've created incentives for the teams. A lot of bootstrap businesses start off and they think that they have communicated a common expectation and understanding with the team, but they haven't. They don't document the things that they should legally. They oftentimes don't incorporate at the time that they should. They haven't assigned the IP that they should. They create tax issues for themselves and the way that they structure the entity. And there's a lot of merit in, you know, just as you're planning your business, plan your relationships, create those relationships through good legal structures, because contracts are not really about the words in the contracts, they're about the process of creating expectations. This thing keeps going up and down in volume, sorry about that. Creating expectations between the parties to those contracts and setting the paradigm for how those parties will operate. And I think a lot of bootstrap companies, they figure the legal aspect of it is something to deal with later, but I can tell you whenever you're dealing with liability with third parties, you want to put an entity in place. Whenever you have more than one person creating the IP, you want to get the IP assigned to the corporation. Whenever you have more than one person involved, you want to deal with the equity. And creating an entity is a good way to start to build brand and to build recognition of that brand and to protect that brand. So I think early bootstrap companies often ignore those things, and they're not that time consuming and they're not that expensive, and they are important because they're incredibly difficult to unwind later.
Interesting. So to get back to that notion that a lot of companies, venture capital has hurt more companies than it's helped, one of the things I'm wondering about, let's assume now we progress through the bootstrapping phase and now we're going to get investment. Is investing in security companies in some way unique compared to other companies? Are there things about them where you think they are the kinds of companies that don't need venture capital because two guys in a garage really can make some, you know, single unique product on their own? Or are they companies that really require scale and they really are the kinds of companies that need venture capital? I guess we'll work our way back to the end again. It seems like a pattern.
I mean, the basic rule is you got to have a separate network because you don't want to let any security team, you know, boot any laptops on your local VC network. No, just kidding. I wouldn't say that there's any special things to do with security startups. There are aspects of the security market that affect outcomes and futures of security companies, which then sort of affect how we in the venture business look at them. Probably the most obvious one is this transition that has happened over the last probably 3-4 years in security from best of breed to integrated players. You see the acquisition spree that Symantec has been on, for example. We don't know if it's going to work out in the end for them, but security was probably the last kind of major market in the enterprise where enterprises bought best-of-breed point solutions and actually managed and integrated them themselves. And that has clearly changed because it requires a lot of skill. Enterprises sort of thought they had that skill. Garden taught them they didn't. I think some of the outsourcing that happened to companies like Garden eventually was a sign of a change needing to happen in industry and consolidation, integration. That's one piece. Second piece is probably the fact that online security around trust, around privacy, we were just at the very, very beginning of that market. And I don't think anyone fully understands the dynamics of, you know, who are going to be the big buyers, what kind of prices are they going to be paying, integrated offering is going to emerge. There's going to be point solutions. So this makes you think about, how big a company can you build before you're forced to sell? Can you build an independent company? Those are probably the biggest set of questions that are different in security than in some other places. And the second one is just the shortage of specific talent in some areas. So one of the companies that many of us here are involved with is Veracode. They do application security, known space with very, very tight talent pool. Not just from a services standpoint, but even for people who actually understand it from an inside development product standpoint, or marketing people who really understand what it means marketing application security. I think the same is true for some of the emerging markets around trust and privacy. Lots of people know network security. You can hire these folks dime a dozen. That market is fairly well developed, but in the others, the talent pool is still very tight.
Do you agree with that? Do you see, and I guess the types of deals that are being presented to you, do you see these kinds of trends that Sim is talking about in terms of the types of security companies, moving from network to application and so forth?
Yeah, I agree with most of what Sim said. The point that maybe I would potentially take issue with, and I think only time will tell, is that you certainly have seen a ton of consolidation with security companies, but I think the jury is still out on whether or not that will mean that enterprises sort of move away from trying to get best-of-breed security products. And I think it's just ebbing and flowing based on sort of what's in the market today. One of the great things about being an entrepreneur and an innovator and an investor in information security is that it's an evergreen problem, right? And companies have become conditioned to recognize that whatever they invested in a few years ago is not what's going to help them meet their compliance objectives, meet their security objectives in the future. And so it's this incredibly rich, welcoming environment for innovation and for investment. And I do think that companies will continue, when faced with a big problem and a very effective, compelling solution, even if it's a point solution from a small company, questionably funded, is this company going to get big? If the solution is compelling enough, I believe that companies will buy it, because maintaining compliance and having best-in-class security solutions to do what they need to do is very, very important to these companies. We've seen a lot of that. I hope it continues. Now, the downside to that is that it has made security a very overhyped, overinvested investment area. And there's this lemming thing where if a couple of firms make investments in a particular area, now all of a sudden there's a rush of dollars in that same area. And I think, like anything else, you have to pick your spots, and an area can get overinvested and overcrowded, and that's a bad thing for young companies, and ultimately it's a bad thing for consumers. But I think largely it follows many of the same patterns as other investments, other than this very, very rich evergreen nature of buying patterns of security solutions.
That buying pattern is comment is pretty interesting, because one of the things I'm curious about is, when you actually go to scale the company and you gear up your sales engine and all that stuff, are there lessons that you guys have seen in the companies either you started or in your portfolio where the sale is somehow very uniquely different with security? I mean, certainly compliance sale is one of the ways you can drive sales, but is that a trap? Do you get pigeonholed as a compliance company? I don't know who best wants to respond to that. Maybe Jeff's making notes, so maybe it's on him.
I'm just jump in for one second.
Okay,
Jeff will probably add on, but I mean, there's a company actually in the Atlas portfolio and the 406 portfolio called Bit9, and Bit9 is a fantastic example of a company that has brought to market an absolutely unparalleled endpoint security solution during a time when companies are shaking, scratching their heads, saying, "Gee, we spent all this money on antivirus, all this money on anti-spyware, all this money on a myriad of other point solutions over the last 10 years." Are we any more secure 10 years later than we were 10 years ago? No. And so they're really hungry for a different approach and a different answer, and willing to overlook the fact that it's private company, one product company today. And I think that, again, speaks to what makes this industry in particular very exciting. Can you do that with an SAP competitor today? Probably not. You can do that with effective security technologies.
So are these security companies, should you be a one-product company? Is that sort of the growth and exit plan for security companies? Because you're faced with needing to be a consolidated or integrated offering, perhaps, to really get acceptance in enterprise, but you can sell a niche solution. So is the plan then to do one thing really well, grow that, and then exit as a single product company and get swallowed up by one of the big guys? What do you think, Jeff?
I mean, I think startups need to focus. And I think that means, you know, focusing on the one product or the one solution. There may be multiple levels of that. You know, for instance, with Eugene's company, it really focused on XML aware networking. You know, security was actually only one aspect of that XML networking. There was, you know, integration, there was acceleration, but it was all focused around XML networking. And I think, you know, Bit9 is focused on, you know, delivering a solution for the endpoint. But it's really around kind of enabling the good guys versus kind of saying, sitting there and, you know, saying we're trying to sell a big fear message. But I think you got to pick your spots. I do think that as startups, especially in security, if you do very well in a single vein with a single product or a single solution, you can then determine how to branch out. Once you have that credibility with customers, once you have that credibility in the marketplace, and I think that, you know, I do think there will be startups that grow to challenge the incumbents out there in these spaces. And it may start with somebody that builds, you know, one point product into a very interesting business and then decides, you know, how to expand that and how to basically aggregate things under one umbrella. But I think for a startup, the one thing that we see more often than we should is a company that comes in and says, you know, oh, we have all this problem because we have all these different technologies we serve. You know, we solve all these different business problems, and it's like you're never going to get anywhere unless you go very deep in one single vein.
Eugene, do you agree with that? I mean, when you were growing Data Power, were you focused on a suite or just trying to do your...
So we had three products, you know, in the end it worked out well, but there was certainly a lot of controversy about having three products. I would go back to an earlier question that you asked that I think is a good one, is it different selling security? Is it different building security products? And I certainly think that it is. And one of the challenges in the application security space is that there have been quite a few companies that claim to offer secure solutions or security solutions and products that actually don't have any security expertise or have very little. I think that that confuses the market, often confuses the buyer, and doesn't enhance the overall level of security. I mean, a typical example of some of our competitors and, you know, many players in the kind of network and security appliance space is people who offer kind of an unpatched, you know, Linux box on a Dell server,
right,
and encourage companies to employ that in the DMZ to provide some kind of filtering. And it brings with it, you know, a bunch of new vulnerabilities by virtue of having, you know, an unpatched vulnerable Unix host running on off-the-shelf hardware in the DMZ, but it's really good at, you know, filtering JPEG viruses. So you don't have a JPEG virus problem, but now you've got kind of a honeypot running in your DMZ thanks to this quote-unquote security company. And I think it's very hard for customers that are buying solutions to assess that. I think they can kind of, in any given focused area, they can assess, does it solve the particular thing that I'm trying to address? But they really have a hard time getting their hands around the overall level of assurance and the overall level of expertise in the company. Is it really just a software company, an IT company, or do they really have security professionals and understand how to deliver a high assurance product?
I think that's the biggest problem with the space, and I think Maria hit on it as well. You know, go walk the floor at the RSA Security Show. Everything sounds and looks the same. You know, this is a space because it has been so overhyped, it has been so overfunded. You know, it's so easy to create, you know, kind of marketecture slides and brochureware. It's really hard to differentiate and tell things apart. You know, and everybody can throw those acronyms up there, and it just, I mean, you think it confuses the customers. I mean, even my IT guy at a 70-person shop like Atlas, I mean, he says as soon as somebody, you know, gets him on the phone, hey, are you concerned about this from a security perspective? It's like click. You know, he's heard it all, and it's so hard for him to make heads or tails of all these solutions out there. So I think it's really hard to differentiate, and I think you have to really do a good job evangelizing, you know, why you're a certain type of security problem and that you're solving the problems that are really hard to solve.
That speaks to the one product idea, doesn't it? Because you got to do one thing really, really well and be very successful at that and be very focused. I mean, the companies that I represent, including Bit9 and back in the day, Data Power, it was a,
you know, a focus of our meetings, trying to define what that one product was and how ultimately we'd be successful with that one product and how we might move that into a platform. But it was always focus on, you know, the product that was going to make a difference, give us credibility in the space. And that changes over time. You know, we, in Data Power, we had endless conversations about what was the right strategy to take this message to the marketplace and who were the, what particular vertical was going to be most accepting of that message. But, you know, it was all about focus. We'd focus and try, and then focus and try somewhere else if it didn't work, and ultimately it was very successful.
So I'm going to ask one more question, then we're going to open it up to questions from the audience. And it sounds to me like, given that there's potentially a lot of noise in this marketplace, maybe there's a lot of noise on the deal flow side as well, given all that, what are the types of companies that you would like to be investing in now? Maybe you could talk a little bit about the types of deals you see, and then what's the type of deal you're not seeing that you'd like to see, or what do you imagine you should be investing in for the future? And the answer is security metrics, by the way, in case you're curious. So we'll start with that at the end.
Well, so if you think about things that I wish I'd see more of, security has historically been reactive, or security solutions have been reactive. I'd like to see more proactive security solutions. I think we have assumed that security and management are those things that get tacked on after something gets built. And that clearly isn't a way to go, but that is how the industry is right now. The majority of code there already is that way. Majority of solutions online are that way. So I'd like to see more companies that are less preachy about the right way something to be built from the ground up with their XYZ amazing security thing, and more pragmatic to saying, here's what the world looks like and here how we can actually fit with it and add this significant step in assurance or security or privacy or whatever to the existing world, as opposed to the world that we wish we lived in. I would like to see, given the tightness of the talent pool in a lot of areas of security, technology leveraged services businesses who leverage that and leverage those people with a lot of technology up front. I would like to see people starting to take trust more seriously, as we now have so many networks and various rings of connections, both online and offline, that are actually very vulnerable to trust attacks. So that's kind of my wish list.
Maria, anything?
Security is really simple. You know, it's, you know, and I didn't come into the security world being a security expert. So, you know, here I was running a security company and all these security people were working for me, and I learned very quickly that you never get away from sort of the simple notion of a triangle, right? And to achieve security, you need a combination of people, process, and technology. And I think what has made this industry very exciting over the last 10 years is that the technology component is all the things that we're talking about, all the things that we've invested in. And at the end of the day, I'm continuing to look for things, and I think, you know, a lot of the things that we've talked about today, Veracode is prime example, you know, Bit9, others, are fantastic technologies around which you needed to wrap a business model that best served the customer's needs. And often, we see these really great technologies, but they're lacking in sort of what I kind of, you know, what I kind of call the last mile in terms of how do you actually solve that problem for customers. So, you know, in a more generic sense, I mean, yeah, we'd love to see really interesting things that solve problems that virtualization causes. There's a lot of people talking about it, but, you know, I haven't seen, and I've looked at several, but I haven't seen yet, you know, something where I say, okay, I get it. This was purpose-built to go solve a big problem that has yet to become a big problem, but will be if virtualization continues at the adoption rate that it is. So, yeah, that's one genre I'd like to see, but in a more macro sense, I'd like to see technologies and appropriate business models that address big problems and disrupt the way that people have been solving those problems historically with legacy technologies. Because the problems don't change, and the basic concept doesn't change. And so I love it. I mean, the Veracode guys were a great example. You know, they came in and they said, you know, we basically help find vulnerabilities that are hard to find in large code bases. Okay, and so does about six other companies that I can name off the top of my head. What's so different about you guys? The smartest security guys out there. It's a lifestyle business. They make a few million bucks a year. He doesn't want to be bought by anybody. Mazel tov, right? Good for him. But is that a venture investment? No. Now, in terms of, you know, would we invest? And so why are technology leverage companies so exciting? Exactly that. You can scale them. You can grow them. You can protect the IP. And those are where you get your 8 to 10x multiples, which I guess we all sort of forgot to mention. This is one of the things that makes investing in security so exciting, is that it is a highly valued, high multiple acquisition game if it's done correctly. But there's a huge distinction between, you know, just, you know, sort of non-leveraged services and services. So, you know, we're looking to invest in services all day long.
I mean, that was rule number one when we sat down around the table on Barracode, was it had to scale other ways besides headcount. And you
if you do not have some sort of a leverage model. I love services. You know, matter of fact, looking at services for a variety of different things, but they are really leveraged services, whether it's, you know, consumer identity theft prevention to a variety of things. You know, it just can't be something that the only way these things scale is through by adding headcount, because that's, you know, that can only scale so far.
David Gammel will tell you that it's very hard to lock down in contracts IP that can walk.
Yep.
So the at-stake experience at Symantec is exactly the reason why services companies don't get valued much. Because, you know, regardless of how Symantec treated you guys, a lot of the best people walked out of the door very, very quickly. And they're in the value of what Symantec acquired got diminished. And so, you know, you can lock code and patents and things of that sort, and it's just hard to lock people down.
But, you know, I think some of the best services companies, best technology leverage services companies, you know, Veracode included, come out of the ability to take what smart people did that was value for customers, take it out of their heads, and wrap code around it, and wrap, you know, a repeatable, predictable model around it, and that's what makes those companies so interesting. So does it start with people? Absolutely. Solving problems for customers.
I miss that stake too. the next question.
What is that?
So I have an idea. I want to start a company around a product. I want to make money with it. Are there other alternatives than going, starting it, bootstrapping at a certain point, and then coming to VCs? How should I do it? What should I try? What are my options? I guess it's more for the entrepreneurs.
The answer is it depends on what your idea is. You should basically figure out what it is, find some people who have done similar things for your network. If you have a hard time finding people in your network who've started companies, then you got some networking to do. But the answer, I mean, it's just, other than this basic sort of talk to some people who can give you good advice, lawyers who have a lot of experience with early stage companies can give you good advice. It's just so many possible ways to launch companies. I mean, forget the financing, is the structure. You can sell early IP to a larger player. I mean, there are literally hundreds of options. So we can give you answers, but the only, I think, real answer is you have to actually get specific about your idea, the market it's going to be in, what are your goals in life. You know, you may just want to be the kind of guy who wants to be an entrepreneur, wants to be on the helm, or you could be the kind of person who just wants to see their ideas succeed and get built into something that delights customers, but don't actually want to be anywhere near the driving wheel, and the answer will be vastly different based on that.
Any other questions? Oh, a bunch. I saw you first. So.
I have a question. I'm going to guess most of you are familiar with Tor, the onion routing project. What do you see any commercial applications for that? Well, I see a lot of commercial applications for it. I'm just wondering, how would you spin it, or what would, I mean, it's obviously open source, so you can take it and spin it into something, but something I've been looking at for a long time. I was wondering, any just general thoughts on that? And I can answer what Tor is if those of you, if you don't know what it is.
So I don't know it that well. I see a lot of companies are wrapping it into their solutions, but I have not, and again, I don't understand it very well, I've not seen anybody thinking of ways to actually build a business on top of it. It just seems like a piece of a solution.
I'll overview it quickly. It's simply a virtual network on top of the internet or any IP-based network that can anonymize and make privacy for almost all traffic. The way it does it is sort of a peer-to-peer network that propagates itself with servers, and only in each hop does the next hop know where it's going. So it's wrapped like an onion, and you keep tearing off until it gets to the exit node, which is the current vulnerability area. If you start monitoring somehow all exit nodes, then you can see where the traffic's going, but you would never know sitting from the beginning, only on an exit node. So it gives you full encryption, et cetera, on all your communications until the last node. And you never know where it's going to be because it's completely randomized. And I think there's thousands of nodes right now running on the internet. It's Tor at electronic EFF.org. So
this is what Elliot Spitzer wished his online bank used.
I'm sold on it.
I knew that was coming.
Does anyone have any other...
I would say that from our perspective, encrypted communication has been a really tough place to figure out how to make money. You know, whether it's, you know, your encrypted cell phone calls to encrypted, you know, email to encrypted other things, you know, just that level of it just has been proven. Maybe it'll happen. I mean, it's starting to happen in some government channels first, but, you know, there has not been a lot of enterprise adoption on that.
Any other questions? Oh, I guess I skipped you for, I'm closer.
Hi, name is Jamie. I actually also worked for Jerry over at Sapien. And then went on to work at Garden for a couple years, actually. I was wondering if you've noticed any trends, and I certainly have, being involved in security as a service at an enterprise level, if you've noticed the trend towards some of these similar security product service companies coming out, claiming that they're enterprise ready, and if you've developed any litmus tests or processes for actually determining if someone new on the block is in fact enterprise ready, as they, you know, you go and you see their booth and they've branded it in big bold letters, you know, enterprise scalable, highly scalable, enterprise ready. What your feelings are of that particular trend in the security market?
This goes, I think, to what you were saying earlier, Jeff, about, you know, you put this Linux box in your network that does the JPEG filtering. So I don't know if you want to. Given ideas.
That was Eugene's example, actually.
Oh, was it? Sorry.
I mean, enterprise ready usually means that somebody actually took their checkbook out and put some money out there. Definition of enterprise ready to me is, again, it's kind of a bastardization of terms. You know, so what's it mean? You know, how many nodes are you actually supporting? How many endpoints are you supporting? You know, concurrent sessions. It's like whatever. It's another term that, you know, people can throw out there to confuse the marketplace. How do we determine if something's, you know, enterprise ready? I think we go out there and we discuss things with people, then we have, you know, our best technologists, you know, kick tires, and sometimes you still don't know. Figuring out solutions that can scale, you know, to whether it's, you know, hundreds of thousands of endpoints, you know, different sorts of nodes, you know, different geographic, you know, layers, it's difficult, and it's always a technology challenge. And it's not always, you know, the hardest technology challenge, but it's a technology challenge.
One of the things to think about is that it's not just the notion of whether something can be deployed in an enterprise and do a good job. That solves kind of that's a bar you got to cross. Then you actually got to think about whether you can do this repeatably in a cost-effective manner to actually build a sales and marketing model and grow a company. And we often find companies who have a handful of customers that are deployed and successful sort of for hook or for crook, with enough services and enough customization, you know, you get the thing to run, you get the customer really, really happy, and that doesn't necessarily lead to another 100 customers getting deployed and being happy in a reasonable time frame. So the solution needs to not only be great and scalable, and I think what Jeff means by scalability, means not just technical scalability, he means business scalability, as in you can actually build a business that repeatedly just churns these things out the door and customers throw them in and they work.
The thing is, if you look at it in the other direction, so from my perspective, I have to service
millions of endpoints, and we have to build our business process around the solution that we select. And of course, I want to see both the time-tested solutions that I'm familiar with, so to provide an example, based on your Tor statement earlier, you know, I'm looking for a global scalable solution for wire level encryption of traffic from either point to point or over a distributed architecture. So, you know, I want to know about our current IPsec deployment and our support over on the voice side and whatnot, but I also want to see who's new on the block. And if there's anything worth looking at. But I find myself spending countless hours looking at folks who've come and are backed by their funders or backed by their sponsors, saying we're highly scalable, we're highly effective in a large corporate or large business environment. And what that means is they do have one or two customers of significant size, but the deployment at that particular company is relatively small, but they're pushing that as marketing and branding and whatnot. So from my perspective, it's cycles spent trying to analyze what enterprise ready means versus, you know, your view of it, we're pushing an enterprise ready solution out to the customer.
So I can give you one more thing from an evaluation standpoint, or something we use to look at companies and something we know enterprises use to evaluate.
vendors, they actually spend a lot of time vetting the QA department of that company and their QA process. In fact, in one of my companies, which I sold last year for a good chunk of change, we actually struck an OEM deal for the product. And the vendor which we struck the OEM come to us and said, could we please include your security, your basically QA testing frameworks as part of the OEM agreement? Because you guys are just invested so heavily in this, we consider this a key part of your IP and we're willing to pay extra. So security is one of these areas where it's hard to do enough testing. So you do need scalability. You know, are they setting up synthetic networks that are in the tens of thousands of nodes? Are they building environments with thousands of virtual machines? Are they, you know, flexibly configuring those? You can learn a lot about a team when you actually talk about their testing organization.
Interesting. And your question?
Hi. For all the people out there who, you know, have an intellectual property, they spend time creating it, what can you say to kind of calm or allay the fears of giving up control of that or coming to a VC and losing control of the original idea or the original dream of their company?
Do you want to start with Eugene on this?
Well, I think there's two really important elements. One is the point that several people have made earlier today, which is being really honest with yourself what you want the outcome to be. You're going to have to give up certain things if you want to be the next Microsoft or Google or the next Cisco. If you want to have a company that forever has 5 or 10 people who are also your best friends, you probably don't want to seek outside financing, or you may only want to seek certain kinds of outside financing. I think that's really important, and a lot of people that I know that have started companies have found through the process that what they thought they wanted wasn't really what they wanted, and that caused a level of conflict and disappointment for all involved, right? So don't fall for peer pressure just because people that you know have started companies and they've been acquired for millions of dollars, but that's not really what you like to do, you don't want to build that kind of company, then you don't want to kind of get on that path, you know, do something else. And I think that the second element is understanding intellectual property law very well, understanding, you know, the legal aspects that, you know, David Gamble talked about earlier, and just being educated about those things and kind of understanding at every step of the way that your role in the company may change, it may have to change, you may no longer be involved full time, but you want to make sure that what you contributed to it at the outset actually returns value back to you. And I think a lot of the time people who create intellectual property, engineers, you know, probably especially in the security space, but in many areas, tend to look down on a lot of the legal and business aspects. And so they don't study them and they don't pay attention. You know, take the time, it's not particularly hard, and take the time to learn about finance and intellectual property and all those other aspects, and you'll probably be well served by it.
And I'd say the biggest thing that you can do to not lose your intellectual property or not have that kind of problem is, one, properly protect it. Two, make sure that you want to accept outside financing, because outside financing then means if you accept that outside financing, you have to succeed with your business plan. Otherwise, if you're not successful and you are not accretive to that business enterprise, it's no longer just your idea, and it's no longer just your baby. And the goal of the venture capitalist is to make money. They have a duty to the limited partners to make money. And so they're going to make money the best way that they can, and that will be with your valuable contribution or without it. But that's the bargain you make when you enter into that relationship, and you need to understand that from the outset and be comfortable with the outcomes that that can produce. And along the way, you want to protect yourself so that you do get some value in that, but that means understanding the process and understanding the financial and business structures that you're creating when you accept that money.
I also think you can do yourself a real disservice if you just focus too much on intellectual property.
Yeah.
And I think security companies in general sometimes succumb to having an overabundance of IP and a real lack of execution skills on the business side.
And I guess this might be, you had a question or?
So I've worked for a couple of different small companies over the years, from AtState that was venture funded and where the VCs brought in a seasoned management team to run it, to a guy that paid me in cash in a foreign currency, and then when that ran a little bit short, tried to give me his motorcycle. What do you guys look for in a leadership team?
How do you like that motorcycle, by the way?
Well, we can get into that later. But what do you guys look for in a leadership team for a company starting out as they try to move through that incubation phase into maybe participating in venture funding? And how do you, and on the flip side, if it's not there in the current company when you get involved with it as an investor, what do you do to help them along?
Do you want to take this, Maria? And then
sure.
We're going to have one more question after this.
So first and foremost, I think we look for leadership that understands that you got to meet payroll with cash, not with motorcycles. Two, I think if there's a situation where we're bringing a management team in and there's founders, we really look for the chemistry between, sort of the seasoned CEO and or other managers that are going to come in and those founders. Because I think the worst thing that can happen is you create an environment where the founders feel disenfranchised, you're not really optimizing the value that you should be getting out of your founders if the management team and the founders aren't sort of the right chemistry and the right fit. Beyond that, kind of depending on the opportunity, but it's typically, first and foremost for us, it's all DNA, right? Who is this person? How do they think? What makes them tick? How have they conducted their life up to date? What successes, have they experienced? So where's their moral compass pointing? And, how do they deal with challenges and adversity? Because that's what a startup company is, all day long, every day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. And how inspirational can they be? Because you're going to want them to attract, other fantastic people to the company. So, how much, can they sort of get the vision and, are they going to be out there and really inspiring both internally and externally around that vision? And then, some experience, perhaps in the domain in which you're asking them to operate, is helpful too. Do they have contacts they can bring to bear? Sort of all the kind of more routine stuff that you would look for in a senior executive. But even beyond before you ever even scratch the experience box, it's all of those other things for us.
I think sometimes it's just really identifying what is the key skill set for the task at hand for the next 12 months. Or next period of time. For instance, when we invested in Bit9, my response to the founders was, I will fund this without a CEO, but we need to have a VP of engineering before we fund it. Because we had a bunch of guys who had, were great at creating science, but they'd never really commercialized that science into a product. And so the last thing I wanted to do was just put in money and waste a bunch of time, just continuing to build science when what I wanted to do was get to a commercial product. So that was not one where we sat there and said, we need a CEO. There's another company that I'm working with right now, and it's in a certain space where I said the most important job in this company is somebody from a VP of marketing perspective that has done these types of customer acquisition strategies in a consumer space before. Doesn't have to be a CEO. Bring the VP of marketing on board, and that's what we need. Just because for me, it's all about taking risk out of the equation and focusing on what can we do with at a time at hand and the money at hand to get to the next inflection point. So sometimes it's a fallacy that as soon as you take money from a venture capital perspective, they want to put this old grizzly CEO in that's worked with them three or four times before. Sometimes, not always.
And then this would be the last question.
I was wondering if you could comment on the role, or if there's any room that you feel there's room for open source with investing in new companies from two sides. One, is it compatible at all? There's a lot of hybrid business models that might include open source. And two, for a potential new company, are there things that you need to make sure to do upfront to make sure that you don't run into things, if you are considering investment in later stages in the company? And, maybe to boil it down to one thing, would you consider investing in a company that has some type of hybrid model, because a lot of the people out here are maybe have a background, sort of a techie or hacker background, who might be more comfortable with the technical side and might start using that as a technical marketing, but if they really want to grow that into the business, is there room for that, do you think?
Well, so I think a common anti-pattern of entrepreneurs is they get enamored with particular technology or particular approach and kind of lose sight of the ultimate goal, which is to build a business that delights customers, of which technology is a really important piece, but ultimately is only a piece. So open source is a tool. makes sense in some situations, doesn't make sense in other situations. In some situations, it's simply a cost reduction measure because, you know, maybe you need to take an existing piece of open source and actually substantially hack it to get it to do what you want it to do. So the short answer, I think any one of us on the investor side would say, would happily consider looking at companies with a significant open source component. We'd want to understand why open source makes sense for that particular company. And probably all of us will react somewhat cautiously to ideology. You know, it's open source because open source is best or because open source is right. We want to actually understand why for this particular situation is it best for the business? Why doesn't it introduce any unnecessary risks? And, you know, there's some great things about open source. I mean, GPL is poisonous if you want to sell enterprise, but GPL is wonderful if you're an online service. You know, it's one of the biggest loopholes in GPL. However, people are talking about closing it. So now you got to think about the risk of picking a piece of infrastructure, building, say, an online service on it, and then the very same thing you're using, you not being able to then take advantage of further development 2 years from now because actually close the hosting loop in the GPL. Wow. You know, how do you think about that?
Yeah, I'm an investor in a West Coast company called Songbird, which is an open source alternative to iTunes. And the reason, you know, open source is because it's a marketing element. That dev community is the early adopters to get this product out there in the market. It really doesn't have anything to do with open source being, you know, the technology tool. It's a marketing tool.
Yeah, we're big believers of open source as well. We've invested in a company called Opteros. You know, they'll do upwards of $30 million this year helping companies figure out how to leverage open source. And, you know, I think, you know, to Sim's point, it's all about, it can't be open source for the sake of open source. Where's the business model that you're wrapping around that? And if there is a business model there, then to us, you know, open source can be a real advantage. And I think some fabulous examples of how open source and business model came together very successfully exist in the security world. Look at SourceFire, you know, and you know, a couple of others. And in fact, I'm a little disappointed that we haven't seen more based on the success of SourceFire and Nessus. And, you know, it makes so much sense. I mean, the smartest security people in the world don't sit under the same roof every day, but they actually do communicate with each other pretty effectively at night.
Excellent. Well, I'd like to thank everyone for taking the time to come here and share their experience and wisdom with us and answer all your questions. So let's thank our panelists. Thank you.
And the moderator.